students, today we are going to understand, analyze and appreciate Vikram Seth's poem Round and Round. Before we go deep into the details of the poem, let us understand the background information to the genre. Indian English poetry, popularly called Indo-Anglian or Indo-English poetry, made its humble beginning under unfavorable circumstances and passed through a bad phase. It came into existence with the British rule and blossomed in the hands of Henry D'Orozio, Kasi Prasad Ghose and the renowned members of the Dutt family. D'Orozio, who is rightly called the national bard of modern India, wrote The Fakir of Jahangira and other poems in 1823, which describes the fate of a Brahmin widow. After D'Orozio, Kasi Prasad Ghose strived to keep the torch of Indo-Anglian poetry burning through his work, The Sher or Minstrel, in about 200 pages in 1830. Ghose wrote a number of poems on Indian festivals, yet Sir Walter Scott's influence was very apparent in his poetry. Professor Dunn rightly remarked his verse, agreeably imitative and everywhere pleasing. The second quarter of the 19th century witnessed the writings of the talented members of the Dutt family like Guru Charan Dutt, Raj Naren Dutt, Michael Madhusudan Dutt and Shoshi Chandar Dutt. They composed verses of different length and quality. But Madhusudan Dutt produced a long musical romance in English, The Captive Lady, in the year 1849, that dealt with the love adventures of Prithviraj Chauhan and Sanyogita. Rabindranath Tagore, a Bengali writer, occupied a significant position in Indo-Anglian poetry. His Gitanjali, a prose poem, brought him worldwide attention. He is now recognized as the poet of the world. Other notable poets during this period were Swami Vivekananda, Malabari, J.M. Tagore, A.M. Kunte, Brajendranath Seel, D.L. Roy, N.W. Pai, Nizamud Jung, Piroz P. Muharjee, Ardeshir M. Modi and Ezekiel Cohen, Sri Aurobindo and Sarojini Naidu. Indian English literature, which began in the 19th century, moved slowly and recorded a stinted growth, but came to a fruitful identity by the end of 19th century and early 20th century. The first award in poetry came in the year 1981 for Jayant Mahapatra's poetry volume titled Relationship. Consequently, till the end of the 80s, awards for poetry were given to poets like Nizam Ezekiel, K.K.N. Dharuwala, Kamla Das and Shiv K. Kumar. Along with these poets, a few more poets comprised the new generation poets after 1930. This new generation poets after independence grew in three decades from the beginning of the 50s till the end of 70s. They provided newer attitudes and sensibility, to some extent better than the earlier group of the poets of the early century. Post-independence Indian English poetry emanated like a movement where not only the above mentioned poets but also many other poets were involved. Bruce King, speaking about the movement, said, "The poetry is part of the process of modernization, which includes urbanization, industrialization, mobility, independence, social change, increased communication, national and international transportation networks, mass education, and resulting paradox that as an independent national culture emerges, it also participates in the international, modern, usually westernized world. P.K. Jagdev, in his unpublished thesis titled Post-Independence Indo-Anglian Poetry, submitted to Utkal University in the year 1997, presented a detailed analysis of the three-decade growth of Indian English poetry. The first decade, that is the 50s, as a transitional decade, as poetry continued with the influence of early romantic and spiritual poetry, and new poetry free from romantic or spiritual influences originated, particularly in the poems of Dom Maurice and Nizam Ezekiel. He called 60s as the decade of creativity, when the changes emerged in the 50s in the form of new poetry, and new poetry bore fruit. Apart from the earlier mentioned two poets, new poets like A.K. Ramanujan, R. Parthasarathy and Kamala Das also emerged as great poets. The 70s is called as a decade of expansion and consolidation, where new poets like Jayant Mahapatra, K.N. Daruwala and Shiv K. Kumar established their stand. Thus, the journey of Indo-English poetry is a journey of origin, growth and development, and finally sustenance. Vikram Seth is widely recognized as a poet, novelist, travel writer and author of children's books. He was born in Calcutta, India. He received his primary and secondary education in India. Later, he studied philosophy, politics and economics at Corpus Christi College, Oxford. He then moved to California to work on a graduate degree in economics at Stanford University. There he got the opportunity to meet Timothy Steele, a poet who largely influenced his work. Seth dedicated The Golden Gate, a verse novel, to him. It was his first novel and was published in the year 1986 when he was only 34 and received Sahitya Academy Award in the year 1988. Later, A Suitable Boy and An Equal Music was published in 1993 and 1999 respectively. A Suitable Boy bagged the Commonwealth Writers' Prize in the year 1994. He published his first collection of poetry titled Mappings in the year 1981 at Nanjing University, China. The period witnessed other poetry books like The Humble Administrator's Garden, published in the year 1985, All You Who Sleep Tonight, published in the year 1990, and the present poem is taken from the same, and Beastly Tales from Here and There, published in the year 1992. Among these works, The Humble Administrator's Garden won the Commonwealth Poetry Prize for Asia. Besides, Seth also has three Chinese poets, published in the year 1992, a collection of translations of Chinese poets, Wang Wei, Li Bai and Di Fu, a libretto, Arion and the Dolphin, published in the year 1994. He captured in words his journey across China and Tibet to India in a book titled From Heaven Lake, Travels Through Xinjiang and Tibet, published in the year 1983. The book secured him Britain's most prestigious travel writing award, the Thomas Cook Prize. His latest work is Two Lives, published in the year 2005, a memoir of the marriage of his great uncle and aunt. Thus, after a careful analysis of his writing career, one agrees that Seth has worked with almost all genres of writing. From 1981 till 2005, his writings include 3 novels, 4 poetry books, 1 book of translation, 1 libretto, a travel book, and a biography. Though Seth mastered almost all genres, he distinguished and established himself in writing novels and poems. He has been established himself as a major writer in the Indian English literature. Critics have highly praised Seth's observational skills and sensitivity to Chinese culture in From Heaven Lake. He is also admired for his ability to accurately communicate that culture to the readers. The Golden Gate also received wide acclaim for its technical virtuosity, inundated with wit and simple language that moved from lofty literary style to colloquial speech. Many critics believed that Seth overemphasized rhyme to decrease the story's depth and character development. Nevertheless, it is regarded as an achievement, especially during a period when strict devotion to meter and rhyme is not generally considered by many poets. The present poem, Round and Round, is taken from All You Who Sleep Tonight, which has 5 subsections, a total 53 poems, including 20 poems of 4 lines each, titled Quatrains. The other subsections are Romantic Residue, which has 9 poems, In Other Voices, it has 5 poems, In Other Places, it has 9 poems, and 4th, Mediations of the Heart, which has 10 poems. Round and Round is the first poem of the subsection Romantic Residue that deals with real life situations. The poem begins by describing a long and miserable journey. The poet describes the journey as long as the journey began in the morning and continued till night. It is described as wretched, as the ever joyful small babies also cried. The happy mood of the passengers was also exhausted because of the tedious journey. The plane jerked and his foot got drenched in whiskey as the flight swayed in an unusual manner. Finally, the poet managed to complete his journey and eventually reached the baggage claim to collect the bag. The second stanza describes the situation near the baggage claim. The passengers stood standstill, eagerly observing the whirligig that moved in a circular motion, carrying all the bags on it. The restless passengers found their bags, which are either in perfect condition or lightly weather-beaten. While all the passengers were busy collecting their bags, a red small suitcase that moved around caught the poet's attention. The poet calls his eyes foolish as he paid lot of attention watching the small red suitcase that was not his at all. The third stanza concludes the journey. The poet looks at the bag and identifies it. He asserts that he knew the bag and it must be hers, whom he did not meet from 7 years. The metal plates on the carousel made a screechy noise and rattled, signaling a pause, and the poet's memories ringed in his mind and constantly talked about his association with the owner of the bag. an old man pulled the bag from the baggage claim without any sense of belongingness. The poet also pulled the bags mechanically when his bags appeared. The poem can be divided into three phases for a better understanding. The poem begins with the mention to an exasperating and tedious journey. After a long wretched flight that stretched from daylight into night, where babies wept and tempers shattered, and the plane lurched and whiskey splattered on my plastic food. After the long journey is over at the destination, the poet comes to finish off the last and routine job, that is, to claim his bags from the baggage claim. This is the first stage where the poet sticks to reality, the reality of a flight. The second stage begins at the baggage claim, where he goes back to nostalgia, springing from the sight of a red and a small suitcase rotating in the carousel, leads to a lost and forgotten relationship in an analogous situation. I knew that bag, it must be hers. We hadn't met in 7 years. And as the metal plate squealed and clattered, my happy memories chimed and chattered. At the end, that is the third phase, is an anticlimax, as well as a realization of how time moves and destroys both dreams and relationship. The poem ends with an emphasis on the acceptance of the hard and harsh realities of life. An old man pulled it off the claim. My bags appeared. I did the same. The poem revolves around a real situation, leading to the reminiscence of relationship and, again, back to actuality in a rhyming pattern. The poet goes back to the past and returns to the present with ease. I knew that bag, it must be hers. We hadn't met in 7 years. The poet rightly explains how time moves without waiting for anybody or anything. Time also exhibits its major characteristic feature, that is, as it moves, it shatters dreams as well as relationship, resuming the strength to face and accept the harsh and hard realities of life and of the present as well. When his eyes catch the attention of the red and small suitcase which is pulled off, the irony and the acceptance of the situation is quite evident, where almost invisibly the happiness of the memory melange with the anguish of the present reality, and the young age fades into the old age. This is clearly indicated in the poem when the poet says, an old man pulled it off the claim. Love and relationship is also an important theme of the poem. He recognizes the small red suitcase even after many years. He talks about the broken and forgotten relationship when he asserts that they haven't met in 7 years. Both the past and the present occupy an important facet of the most of the poems of the subsection Romantic Residue. For example, in the poem Protocols, the intimacy of past love is contrasted and contradicted with the pain of the present broken love. Now that the facts are plain, the placid surface cracked, the protocols of friendship broken, and in a related reference to nature, the poet wishes affection and happiness to her, free from whatever may be her sorrow. May the sun burn away these footprints on the lawn and hold you in its warmth and keeping. Similarly, in the poem Round and Round, the poet goes back to nostalgia after watching the small red suitcase and immediately returns to the present when an old man pulls it off at the baggage claim. In his introduction to the poems 1981-1994, Seth asked three questions to himself related to poetry. The first question was, how did I begin to write it? Secondly, why do I write so much of it in rhyme and meter? Thirdly, do I see myself as an Indian or American or Commonwealth writer and as a poet or a novelist? Surprisingly, he himself answered them. While answering the first question, he pointed out that he started to write poems when he was unhappily in love as a university student. However, he believed that the poems were exaggeratedly sentimental and memorable only for their banality. To the second question, he accepted that most of his poems are written in free verse. That's because he read Whitman or Lawrence widely, and when poetic lines came to his mind, when he needed the help of poetry, either to delight or remind or suggest or console, was almost unfailingly in meter and often in rhyme. Simultaneously, he pointed out it was rather difficult to explain the emotional power of such poetry and said that since verse and form is what I usually find myself writing. To the third question, he answered that such imaginative categories were, though fascinating, yet irrelevant in the final analysis. Vikram Seth's poetic style is dominant by many remarkable features. Some of these may be highlighted for a brief assessment. Firstly, though he has strong inclination towards arranging his poems on the lines of a prose, in a prose pattern, yet he freely exploits rhyme, half rhyme, even in the style of a song, whenever the situation demands. The following examples from his poems help us to understand his use of end rhyme in the combination of prose and conversational style. Another example from Round and Round proves a point. After a long and wretched flight that stretched from daylight into night, where babies wept and tempers shattered, and the plane lurched and whiskey splattered. No matter what the rhythmic arrangement is, there is invariably a blend of prose style which is often conversational in tone and at times argumentative. At the same time, it may be noted that this merge of prose and poetry is totally accomplished. The prose aspect in poetry enumerates a very pleasing dimension to the overall aesthetic invocation to Seth's poetry. A notable aspect of Seth's poetic style is his everyday use of epithets, which are present in large numbers and in almost every poem. He can be compared to Keats in this aspect. The epithets provide compact and real images by themselves. Seth also creates images through appropriate combination of words and phrases. Contextually, they are limited yet provide evocative pictures to enrich the poetic structure. Even plain words with adjectival and fine refinement provides an important element to the totality of Seth's writing style. Some such words used in the poem may be listed as plane lurched, plastic foot, foolish eyes, brave suitcase, etc. In a different way, The words also reveal a context, a situation, even a frame of mind or ambience. Thus, as in the poem, long and wretched flight, babies wept, plane lurched, anxious travelers, foolish eyes, circled round, happy memories, an old man pulled, etc. All these words not only denote the poet's mood, but also describe the context and the situation of the poem. The above words also talk about the poet's restlessness. Restlessness in the journey, both in flight and in life. Restlessness at the sight of a small red suitcase. And restlessness when it was pulled off by an old man as an indication of permanent strain in relationship with her. The use of irony used in both short and large contexts is all encompassing. In most of his poems, and round is no exception. Seth's comparison of his eyes as foolish. Foolish eyes is a clear indication of the above point. Thus, Seth's poetic style has many features. Starting from the use of prose pattern as an aspect of poetic structure to the appropriate use of epithets. Images that provide necessary accompaniments to the use of wit, humor and irony as part of attitude and point of view. The readers travel to many other aspects like defining the situations, atmosphere and providing a concrete picture through complete and detailed observations to developing a tone ranging from frivolity to ruminative and from individual attachment to distant detachment and showcasing skilled descriptive and narrative technique. Finally, another interesting feature of Seth's style is it echoes the style of many past poets, especially British poets like T.S. Eliot, Keats, Wordsworth, Arnold, Fitzgerald, Donne, Yeats, Shakespeare, Larkin, as well as to European authors like Homer and Dante, and even Indian poets like Nizam Ezekiel. It is referred to as interesting because they do not directly influence Seth's writing style. They come along lightly and casually without much strain and support illuminatingly in particular contexts. Let us conclude. Vikram Seth considered himself as an Indian and chiefly as a poet and pointed out that the desire to write about anything is such a rare and mysterious feeling that it is pointless to preempt or constrain it by notions of subject or geography or genre. Seth's poetic art and his view on his poetic art and craft are enlightening. A thorough analysis of his poems would prove the point. I hope you all understood the poem and enjoyed. Thank you.